Yo, what's up? Yes, today I make a special episode about IONITY raising prices on the charting. Yes. So before I begin, please guys, my regular followers, whenever you see stuff shared all over the place on Facebook and Twitter, whatever, please don't send me message about that case. I already know about it, you know. Every time a car catches fire, every time when the big fire happened at the Seoul airport, you know, I heard about it. So please don't spam me with messages. And sometimes I get 50 messages from 50 people, different people, and they all want to hang out and chat with me, but you know, I'm kind of busy making videos. Yes, anyway, so the video will be about IONITY. You know, the introduction price of 10 euro per charting session is going to go away now by the end of January, and from now on there will be a hefty price if you go for drop-in. So I'll come back to that. And you know, this video is going to show you what will it actually cost to use IONITY, and also to counter the fossil lovers, because I can see this coming, you know. Those stupid news agents, whatever, you know, they will always make incorrect headlines and say that, you know, charging an EV will be twice as expensive as diesel. Well, I will show you cases where that could be the case, but I will also show you, you know, how you can avoid getting ripped off like that. And the bottom line is that using electric will still be cheaper than fossil, and it's of course cleaner than fossil. So alright, I prepared this spreadsheet here. Let me explain a little bit, okay? I use a few examples here. We have e-tron 55, and then we have that, okay, maybe I should explain before. Yes, you have the Audi charting service, which is a subscription-based service. I am not a fan of it. I don't like subscription-based stuff. In my opinion, it should just be open for everyone. You know, just think about it. When you go to a gas station, you don't have to, you know, okay, you get some fuel over there, but if you have a subscription at Shell, you will get cheaper fuel. No. It's just the way it works today with gas stations works great. It means you have free competition between them. And I actually wonder if the Norwegian authority, the competition authority in Norway, or you know, in other countries, if they agree with this, because the problem with this price model is that you kind of restrict customers to stay with them rather than, you know, freely choose between other providers. So this is not good for competition, and it's not good for, you know, reducing the price for the customers. But okay, that's a different case. But anyway, you have to pay about 20 euros per month for this transit subscription. And that allows you to, instead of paying 0.79 euros per kilowatt hour, which is the drop-in price, then you only pay, well, it depends on each country, but you pay about 0.33 euros throughout Europe. That is actually pretty good. I will show you now how good of a bargain it can be. But I also point out that for Tesla, it's still really cheap for many countries, because in Tesla, you pay, in Norway, it's 0.17 euros per kilowatt hour. And then throughout Europe, it's about 0.3 euros per kilowatt hour. So there will actually be some countries where IONITY is cheaper than Tesla still. So I will come back to that. But let me show you here. Okay, back to the spreadsheet. So I prepared now a couple of cars. You might be wondering, where is your car? Well, I can't include all the cases, but at least I include a thirsty car, and then an efficient car, a Kona, and then a Model 3 because it's Tesla, and then we have diesel. Yes. So here is the rough range numbers for these cars, and the monthly fee for the transit, roughly 20 euros. It might be 19 euros or whatever. Yeah. And then, how much would it cost to fully charge it if you fast charge it at IONITY or supercharger or the gas station? You can only, there is no home refueling service there. But you see that it's a hefty price if you want to fully charge an e-tron. You can already see now that if you get the transit, it will be way cheaper. So you see the monthly fee for the transit plus the full charge price, it's still lower than if you drop in Yeah. But when it comes to Kona, for example, well, it's still better, see? Even for Kona, but I will show you cases where, you know. Okay, let's come back to that. And then for Model 3, this is supercharger in Norway, okay, in the rest of Europe, it will be more expensive. Then it should be almost twice as expensive. So then it'd be about 25 euros for a full charge. That's actually slightly more than Kona, you see? And then this is price for charging at home in Norway. We have dirt cheap electricity, so of course I use the best case for at least electric cars. But okay, well, you can just estimate what it would cost for your country. But you see, it's really cheap to charge at home, and this is the whole clue. Charging at home, that's what makes it even better, you know. So this is why driving electric is superior to fossil. So here we have the price. Of course, it would be the same if you have the transit or not. And then this one is the price per kilometer if you fast charge. So now I see if you fast charge with drop-in at IONITY, then it's going to be really expensive. So this is what I fear that some stupid newspaper company will do, is that they will take the price per kilometer on the drop-in and then compare with fossil. And then they make headlines and say that driving electric is twice as expensive as fossil, you know? So yeah, please, let's hope that doesn't happen. Because if you break it down, you will see that that is not the case at all. So here we have e-tron. If you have the subscription, the transit is way, way cheaper. And then Kona, because it's more efficient, it's also cheaper. And then it's even cheaper if you have the transit deal. And actually almost as cheap as Model 3, you see? Again, I already see now comments on YouTube, I mean, sorry, comments on Facebook, the Tesla lovers will be like, oh, ha, lol, 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 it's so much, Tesla is way cheaper. Well, it is cheaper in many cases, but it's not that cheaper if you use a transit. Yeah. So let's take a typical case here. If you drive from Oslo to Bergen, how much would it cost for the energy, for the propulsion part? Okay, if you don't have a subscription, again, it will be somewhat expensive. Now, I take in account that we charge, fully charge from home, so that's cheap. And then you only have to top up on the way there. So it's still kind of expensive, but if you go for the transit deal, then it's cheaper. So already see now that even if you have just one trip to Bergen, for example, per month, it still pays off to go for the transit. As for Kona, the gain is smaller. And why is that? Well, because Kona has more range. So the amount you need to top up, it's only 50 kilometers, you know? So it's not that much. My advice then for Kona owners is that, or a similar car in an e-Niro or whatever, is that if you don't drive that far, then transit is not, it's probably not a good deal for you. Because you will see in the other case here that when you go on a 1,000 kilometer challenge, it would be a good deal, but how often do you do that? And the problem with the transit deal is that it's a 12-month subscription. Yeah, you can't just say, okay, I just wanna, you know, sign for it now, 1 month, and then no. So that's, you see, that's what I don't like about the transit deal, is that you have to make a contract for a whole year. Yeah, that's not good for competition, you know. Even if you can just at least make it, enable it for 1 month and then stop there, only 1 month at a time, that would still be better. Yes, so hopefully the competition authorities in different countries, they can make some restrictions, because I'm not sure if this is, well, it's probably legal, but yeah, people probably don't like it, including me. All right, as for a Model 3 long range, again, that one can do the whole trip without recharging. So that's why it's the same price as home charging. And as for diesel, again, diesel loses in every case here, you see. Even against e-tron without transit, it's still more expensive. And I haven't counted toll roads even, because in Norway, you don't pay for toll roads for EVs, at least outside of Oslo. In Oslo, you pay a reduced fee, reduced toll road. So actually, the real cost here, if you include toll road and includes, was again, oil change and some crap, then the diesel is even more expensive than this. And then what about the case of 1,000 kilometer challenge then? Yes, you see, I'm so fortunate that I have done those tests and I know how this shit works. So I also calculated, I left out some detail, it's going to be way too detailed, but I already worked out how much it will cost on the 1,000 kilometer challenge. Now, in this case, the speed is higher. and the consumption is higher, and therefore you spend a little bit more energy, and the cost is higher, basically. So in this case, you will see that an e-tron will in fact be twice as expensive as a diesel if you do the 1,000 kilometer challenge. But it's a no-brainer, you know. If you have an e-tron and you drive far that often, then you should get the transit deal, because then you slice the price into less than half. But even if you include the monthly fee, you know, it would be half the price, basically. So then it boils down to, when you have an e-tron, how much do you actually drive? How often do you drive and all that, you know? Because there was one thing here. E-tron owners, they get the first year for free. Yeah, that, isn't that great? Yeah. But the problem is that some people, they received the e-tron last year, whatever. And that means that by the time this new price model takes in effect, then maybe 1 year passed or whatever. So it means that it's kind of unfair for them, right? To be fair, if Ionity listens to me, you guys should give 1 year for free from this day, from 1st of February to, you know, yeah. But I don't know, that's just a suggestion. But okay, you know, what people could do is they could sell the e-tron now, and then they could buy a new one. But then, you know, it's only 20 euros. So you're basically saving 240 euros. So, I mean, if you can afford an e-tron, you can afford 240 euros, right? Yeah. Okay, but in the case of Kona, again, it's also pretty high. Even though Kona has higher, better efficiency, but eventually, you know, you have to fast charge a lot. And of course, with transit, it's cheaper. But keep in mind that, you know, when I do those 1,000 kilometer challenges, the whole point of it is that I want to show people that electric cars can be as fast as fossil car. Well, at least that's for e-tron and Teslas. They are pretty fast. You know, I want to show them that they can be as fast as fossil cars. That's why I just go fast. I hammer at 135 kilometers per hour where I can. Don't tell the Swedish policing. Yes. So in your case, you will probably not drive that fast. I think most people, you know, they will cruise at 110-ish kilometers per hour or whatever, you know. And then the real price for them will actually be even lower here. Yeah. And then in the case of Model 3, of course, we have cheap charging. So the Model 3 wins here big time versus the other ones. And there is no monthly fee or whatever. So that's always good. And again, diesel losers. Yes, diesel is always the loser. And by the way, I heard recently that the diesels are actually dirtier than they are in reality, because there is this cleaning cycle that the particle filter does, which is not counted in the test procedure. So in the testing procedure, there was a news. Euro 6 is not as clean as people claim it is. Yes, it's a fact now. Euro 6, when they test it and get nice results, but then outside the test, the car will perform a cleaning cycle and will dump lots of shit out of the car, lots of particles and nooks and whatever crap. I don't remember what it was. Just the pollution level when it does the cleaning, you know, part is just insane, you know, goes through the roof. So the cars, they do all that shit. So again, diesel loses big time. Yes. But okay, anyway, let's go over to this one. I updated the spreadsheet. So you guys have seen it before in the earlier video. So I updated with the new price on Ionity. And of course, if you go for drop-in, well, okay, I didn't write it, but Ionity is 350 kilowatts. By the way, okay, I should mention that one also. Why is it so damn expensive? You know, why is Ionity taking such a big profit? Well, I'm not defending Ionity about how expensive it is and all that, but you know, keep in mind that I asked them about prices, how much did it cost to install all this, how much does the hardware cost, and they didn't want to give me the numbers. But I asked some other charge point operator, and they gave me some rough estimate that a typical charging site with some, let's say, 2 times 150 kilowatt fast chargers will usually cost about 1 to 1.5 million nook, or let's say 100 to 150,000 euros for installation cost, for a transformer, for You know, making that the concrete foundation, maybe a little shed and stuff, you know, and actually the hardware and stuff, you know, paving the stuff. So you see that it's somewhat expensive just for the investment, and then you also need a back-end system. You need communication. On these chargers, they have 4G SIM card in it. You also have to pay for that communication and also support. Like Ionity, they have 24/7 support actually in several languages. I think they also have support in Norwegian. But if I call Ionity, I will ask for Helga. I want it in Deutsch. No, but you see, all of this stuff costs money, you know. You guys have to stop comparing home charging with fast charging, you know. Eating Thai food at the restaurant will always be more expensive than eating wife's home Thai food, you know. You just have to understand how that shit works. So fast charging is going to be expensive. But I ask Ionity, hey, you know, you guys have 350 kilowatt fast chargers, 800 volt based system, and not many cars can utilize that because, well, it's basically just Taycan. All the other cars, they can only utilize 100 to 150 kilowatt, 400 volt. So how, what if you guys use, install 150 kilowatt fast charger instead? And the response from Ionity was something like, you know, they could do that, but again, the initial cost for the whole framework around it, you know, the transformer, the foundation, the cables, whatever, it's already pretty high, especially because they don't just put up one or two chargers, they put up four or six or eight chargers on each location, which is brilliant because when you go there, you know, you don't have to worry about, when I do the 1000 kilometer challenge, I never check the app that, oh, it's speculated available, you know. No, I just go there and it's available, you know, there's always one stall, and usually most of the time, you know, there's plenty of stalls available. And that's what I like about it. That's what drives electric mobility forward, you know, rather than having one charger and then it's occupied and then you sit there and like, oh shit, what do I do now? Yeah. They claim that 150 kilowatt, you know, if they downgrade 150 kilowatt, it's not going to be that much cheaper versus 350 kilowatt. And Ionity, they have the philosophy that they want to be future proof. So, okay, that's good. That's fair enough because it means that they will have the foundation for EVs in the future to adapt to go to 800 volt system. So okay, that's fair. Maybe in the future we will see more 800 volt cars, but personally for me, from what I know about EVs, there are some disadvantages with 800 volt system, which is basically the main problem with 800 volt system is that most other systems are 400 volt, you know, the 50 kilowatt and the 150 kilowatt fast charger, they are 400 volt based. And then the Taycan has to do some weird shit that it has to get a DC-DC converter and stuff. So it charges slower and it has more losses when you charge on the 50 kilowatt fast chargers, you know. And I still believe that 50 kilowatt and 150 kilowatt fast chargers will exist for a very long time. I'm talking about at least 10 to 20 more years, simply because there are still so many cars coming out today and existing today that are 400 volt. So, you know, the 400 volt system will not go away for a very, very long time. But okay, that's a different story. It's a little bit out now, but so yes, Ionity is going for 800 volt system. And okay, the price you see here is pretty high. So it gets a red marking here if you do drop in. But when you do transit, it's actually a pretty good deal. Because if you compare that, since last time, Fortum, they have raised the price. So for 50 kilowatt fast charging, it used to be 2.5 nook per minute, now it's 3.1 nook per minute. And then for 150 kilowatt fast charging is 2.5 kilowatt hour per it's 2 nook per minute plus 2.5 nook per kilowatt hour. And you actually see that with 150 kilowatt fast charging, it's getting a bit expensive even for 50 kilowatt fast charging. So you see, if you go for transit and you fast charge a lot, then actually the 3.2 nook per kilowatt hour beat most other providers in Norway at least. That's pretty good. Well, except for Tesla, I guess. Tesla is 1.6. Oh, it's, wow, this, I just realized now that spreadsheet is too big. Tesla is out there somewhere, but Tesla is 1.7 nuke per kilowatt hour. Yeah. All right, and this is in Norway. So what about Sweden? Okay, Sweden looks like this. Again, drop-in is very expensive, but if you go for transit, then it's a good deal. Yes, it's again, okay, and also since last time, I have to tell you guys that charge point operators, they watch my videos and they probably realize that, oh, Eon used to be 50 SEK per charging session. They raised the price to 95 SEK per charging session. They probably realized it was too expensive. Oh, this one should have been red, by the way. Oh, okay, let me just update that. But, you know, so they raised the price because it was obviously too cheap. And then as for Virta, it used to be 2.5 SEK per kilowatt hour. Now it's 2.5 SEK per minute. So that's why the prices have gone up a little bit here. But as for the transit deal, okay, if you go for Eon, it's still a good deal for cars with big batteries, you see. But it charges kind of slow, it's 50 kilowatt. And then as for Vattenfall and the other ones, yeah, okay. I'm not sure about Fortum. I have to check if they updated the prices. But it's the transit price in Sweden is still very good. Okay, it doesn't beat Tesla in this case. See, Tesla is still cheaper. But let's look at the last one now, Denmark. So for Denmark, it's actually looking pretty good because the drop-in price in Denmark, even the drop-in price in Denmark is lower than the drop-in price for Clever or Eon or whatever. But again, Danes, they usually have some kind of subscription in Clever or Eon. So they can charge for almost free, whatever, you know, over there. Well, actually, I think that's how it is. They pay a fixed price per month and then they can charge as much as they like. But the transit price on in Denmark for Ionity is dirt cheap, man. 2.5 Danish kroner per kilowatt hour. That is a bargain. It's, you can see here, you know, it's even cheaper than Tesla. Yeah, that's just insane how they did it, you know. So I guess Danes, they could, I guess, they could just ditch Clever and Eon and get the transit deal, maybe. But, okay, on the other hand, I don't know. You know, the whole transit deal is for Audi only. So I don't know what is going to happen with, for example, Hyundai owners or whatever. But, you know, I will probably guess that they will also have a similar deal. You know, why would a Hyundai offer a worse deal than that? And I know that Volkswagen, they have the ID3. You get, how much was it again? You get some kilowatt hours for free. I don't remember exactly. Actually, let me just check one of my different. Yeah, 2,000 kilowatt hours for free or something the first year. Or how long? How valid it was? Okay, I don't remember how long it lasted. But you see, I bet that most car manufacturers who are within the Ionity group, you know, they will have some kind of good deal in it. So, you know, basically what I'm saying is that for some people, it sounds like Ionity is freaking expensive, and it is expensive for drop-in. And if you don't drive a lot on long trips, then don't care about the transit deal. But if you drive a lot, then you better get it, especially for thirsty cars like e-tron owners, and I'm not sure about other cars, but again, whether you should get the transit or not, that's a different story, I guess. But yeah, so again, let me point out again that the 1,000 kilometer challenge, in that one, yes, it looks like if you don't have a deal, if you go drop-in, it would be more expensive. But you know, that is not a regular case. Actually, for most people, they will not be affected by this. They will just drive around town, you know, Kona owners, even e-tron owners, I-Pace owners, whatever. They go to work and then occasionally they take a weekend trip, but they don't drive that far. They drive 200, 300 kilometers to the cabin, you know, and that's it. And some people, they go, let's say, from Oslo to Bergen, Oslo to Stavanger, or Oslo to Gothenburg or whatever. And, you know, it's not going to cost them a fortune. So still, again, bottom line is that, yes, it's expensive for drop-in, but it's not expensive if you go for transit, and it's still cheaper than diesel. Yes, so I think that's gonna be it for now. Oh yeah, one last thing I should mention, which is that because of this, you know, the good thing about this new price model is that it will probably shoo away Tesla owners from Ionity. Until now, I've seen some Model 3 owners charge at Ionity, and it might also shoo away some i3 owners and some e-Golf owners. So it's actually a good thing that they introduced this price model, because then most likely there will mostly be e-trons and i-Paces charging over there, and maybe an occasional Kona or whatever. So less queues at the Ionity chargers, right? Yeah. But anyway, I think that's going to be it for now. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. As always, thank you for watching, and talk to you later.